All right. Okay, so welcome to the IES microplastic lecture series. So today our speaker is Dr. Lefselia Chats-Seaman. Sorry, so she is a senior lecturer at University of Edinburgh. In water and environmental engineering in University of Edinburgh since 2019. Prior to that, she holds a Chancellor's Fellowship position from the same university. She got her PhD and Master in Environmental Engineering from the Technical University of Crete in Greece and received her Master of Engineering in the Chemical Engineering from the Aristotle University of Thessaloniki from Greece. Celia is associate editor in Frontiers in Environmental Science, Water and Wastewater Management Journal. I know she is also a member of the editorial board of the Environmental Technology and Innovation Journal. She keeps a long tracking record the development of technologies for water and wastewater treatment. They use life cycle assessment to assess the sustainability. Her research was financially supported by, for example, the GCRF, Scotland government, and also EPS, SRC, NERC, and EU funds. She's captivated by the impact of microplastic pollution in water and is currently exploring how existing water and water and wastewater oxidation processes can alter the physical, chemical properties of microplastics that act as a carriers of pollutants into the environment. All right. Okay, you can start, Sarah. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Geng, for the introduction. Thank you so much. Let me share my screen.
Okay, no problem. You can start.
Okay, perfect. So, hi all, good afternoon here in the UK. I'm Thalia Hadjisimeon. Don't worry, Geng, it's a Greek name, so no one can pronounce it in Greek, properly, but no worries. So today I will talk about microplastics and the effects of them of these pollutants on wastewater treatment technologies and in wastewater treatment systems. Microplastics, plastics is a major problem, a major environmental problem, and this is because these substances are persistent, non-biodegradable organic pollutants and can have a long lifespan, which can be up to a few hundred years when these are discharged into the environment. Today we'll focus on microplastics, which are plastics with a diameter of less than 5 millimeters, and they have been detected. They are being detected everywhere in air, water, and soil. And talking about wastewater treatment systems, microplastics is an emerging problem, an emerging issue for the treatment of wastewater and drinking water as well. And the industries, the water industry, in their race to reduce their emissions and to achieve their net zero target, they are trying to find ways to mitigate this problem, mitigate pollution from microplastics. Regulations are not in place yet, but there is guidance. And for example, for the UK, the net zero policy, the net zero targets from the government say that water industry should reduce their emissions coming mainly from energy consumption by 2030, But by 2050, they should also reduce their emissions coming from the processes, from treatment processes, which means they need to reduce pollution, emissions coming from discharging of pollutants, either gas pollutants or pollutants in water. So there is a huge interest and a huge research on microplastics in wastewater treatment and in water treatment systems nowadays. And the problem with this is that traditional wastewater treatment plants were not initially designed to remove such type of persistent pollutants, including micropollutants. And because of this, a large amount of micropollutants, they escape, and they escape from the treatment systems, and they are eventually discharged into our environment. And it is interesting to see or to think about the sources of pollution in wastewater treatment plants, sources of microplastics pollution. First one are personal care products, for example, face scrubs that contain or used to contain microbeads and plastic microbeads. And although in many countries, including the UK and Europe, microbeads in personal care products have been forbidden, there are still areas around the world that still microbeads are used in personal care products. And there are studies that show that pollution from microbeads in wastewater treatment systems can be up to some billions of microbeads every year, which is a huge number if we think about it. Another source of pollution are textiles and clothing. So, and lots of textiles and clothing are now made of polyester. And that's one thing. Textiles are now made of polyester, but also we are the modern way of living and fast fashion revolution. So the fashion is changing very rapidly. So we need to change clothes and textiles. You know, huge consumption, overconsumption of textiles and clothing. And all these are washed, and it has been estimated that from a single cycle of a washing machine, laundry washing, up to millions, 6 millions of microfibers can be released into the washing water, which will eventually get into wastewater treatment systems. Another source of pollution are tire wear particles. Tire wear particles and storm water will lead these microplastics into the sewage system and will end up in wastewater treatment plants as well. The other source of pollution are plastic pellets. Plastic pellets are tiny microbeads, biobeads, that are used for wastewater treatment, for example, biological treatment of wastewater. And there are technologies to remove these plastic pellets, but a small amount, a small part of this will remain in the wastewater. And the last source of pollution here are macroplastics. So bottles and other big plastics objects that will be cracked and fragmented into smaller and smaller and smaller pieces, and eventually microplastics will come out of this rubbish, and will get into wastewater treatment. And from wastewater treatment plants, we have one stream of pollution, if I can say, which is the sewage sludge, and microplastics will enter into sewage sludge. And the truth is that most of the microplastics from wastewater treatment, let's say about 90%, will go into the sludge, and only 10% will enter into the effluent, the treated effluent. But even this 10%, this part, might translate in large amounts in absolute values. And even these concentrations will have adverse and toxic effects on the ecosystem, on the environment, and through the water cycle, eventually to human health. Similarly, the microplastics that are found in sewage sludge, which after some processing, the sewage sludge can be applied on agricultural land as an organic fertilizer, for example. But the microplastics that are found in this will also find their way through soil into natural water bodies and into the environment. And there are many studies that have detected the occurrence of these amounts of pollutants into the environment and into water. And also, there are lots of studies studying ways to mitigate this pollution from microplastics. And here in these two graphs, we can see technologies for mitigation of microplastics pollution. And these technologies have been grouped, categorized into big categories on physical, chemical, and biological technologies. And for example, we can see screening and settling, sedimentation, coagulation, adsorption, filtration, oxidation technologies here, like photocatalysis, Fendon, and ozonation, and biological processes. And in the first graph, we can see the amount, the number of publications based on the shape of plastics that were studied. And we can see that the particles, we have more publications that studied particle microplastics. And this is followed by pellets. We talked before about plastic pellets in wastewater systems. And we can see that photocatalysis is mainly studied in this case. The same stands for the type of plastic that was investigated. So, for example, photocatalysis oxidation was the mostly studied process, and the plastic, the material that was mostly studied was polyethylene. There's a huge amount of products, plastic products made of polyethylene, for example, plastic bottles or single-used caps and other materials. And it's normal, it was expected that this would be the mostly studied plastic material. Photocatalysis now, we can see that Why photocatalysis was mostly studied? So photocatalysis can be used at large scale, although it's not very common to be used in big cities, in big wastewater treatment plants, for example, but can be used in remote areas, smaller communities, wastewater treatment plants. So is a process that can be applied at scale, but also photocatalysis is about using radiation to get the energy in order to oxidize pollutants. So this is a process which is very relative to weathering methods, artificial weathering methods that have been developed for microplastics. So this can explain, I would say that this could explain the interest on this process. And we'll talk a lot. We have done a lot of work here about photocatalysis of microplastics, and this will be the focus of this presentation today. Another graph that is of interest and would like to discuss is the technologies that have been used for mitigation of microplastics and the removal percentages that have been achieved with all these technologies. Again, after reviewing publications that has been done on these topics, we can see that physicochemical technologies like screening, settling, sedimentation, coagulation, and adsorption can achieve very good, I would say, removal efficiencies ranging from about 50% to 80 or even 90%. And in the case of filtration, we can see that removal can go up to 98%. So basically, removing, achieving complete removal of microplastics. Of course, all technologies have some technical challenges, I would say. And filtration technologies come with the disadvantage that microplastics can frequently block the adsorbent, the pores of the adsorbent material or of the filter or the membrane pores if we are talking about membrane technology. And in this case, we need frequently to clean the material or even replace the material if cleaning is not the sustainable method to do. Here we can also see the biological processes which do not actually achieve very high removal rates. The removal can go up to 20%. But again, in my opinion, I believe it's good, for research to keep going and try to, with every means that we have, every technology that we have, try to push the boundaries in this and see the capabilities of each technology. And then we can see advanced oxidation processes here. And removal percentages ranging significantly from 5% to 98% again. And we can see a very huge variation here for two reasons. One reason is that oxidation processes is a group of technologies, and more than 10 or 15 technologies are included in this big group. And also, treatment time in all these publications that we reviewed ranges a lot. So treatment time is from a few hours and goes up to 7 days in all these publications. And we know that as we increase the treatment time, the efficiency, the removal efficiency is always increased. So that's why there is a big variation here. And the focus of this presentation will be on advanced oxidation processes and discussing this a lot, keeping in mind the big potential that they have, but also the contradictory results that we got here from different publications. I'm sorry, is it? Oh, okay. Now it's full screen, sorry for this. So we can, as I said, we'll talk about photocatalysis, and we said that oxidation processes is a big group of oxidation processes. It includes electrolysis, wet oxidation, photophendon, photoelectrocatalysis, onolysis, and more of other processes. And the main characteristic of all these processes is the generation of hydroxyl radicals. Hydroxyl radical is a very strong oxidant that can attack, can react with organic molecules and split it into smaller molecules until at the end gets into mineralization of the water, which means that getting into the production, the formation of CO2, carbon dioxide, and water without any other byproduct at the end. And the key advantage of these processes is that they can actually destruct the organic molecules, as we said, into CO2 and water, and without transferring the pollution or these initial molecules into a different phase, like filtration, for example, does. Of course, in order to get to that final end, to mineralization, we need a disadvantage of these processes is that we need long treatment times for some pollutants, and maybe energy consumption might be another technical challenge that prevents the deployment of these processes at large scale. However, there's still year by year lots of advances in this field, and these processes have become even more sustainable and environmentally friendly than they used to be some decades ago. I'm sorry. So we tried, we applied oxidation processes, photocatalysis, for the removal of PET, polyethylene, terephthalate fibers from wastewater, and specifically from laundry wastewater. And we did this, we focused on UVC photocatalysis here, rather than other types of irradiations, taking into account that UVC is a process that currently exists in wastewater treatment plants, but is used for disinfection purposes. So UVC treatment is usually the last stage in wastewater treatment systems. And the purpose of this is to disinfect, to inactivate all bacteria and other pathogens in wastewater in order to finally release it into the environment. So the rationale of this work was to investigate what can happen to microplastics if they go through UVC treatment. And depending on the results, this would be a technology that it could be readily used for microplastics treatment because this is already set up in big scale treatment plants and it is a well-established technology. So these are here in the photo, you can see the fibers in water that we used for lab scale experiments. And in this graph, you can see the mass loss that was achieved, the mass loss of microplastics that was achieved during the experiment. So results show that when UVC alone was deployed, then the removal of microplastics was about only 7% after 9 hours of treatment, but this was increased to 10%, about 10% when UVC radiation was coupled with hydrogen peroxide. Hydrogen peroxide is another oxidant, and this together with UVC can create even more hydroxyl radicals into the water, and that's why we can see an increase in the oxidation rate of the organic substances, of the organic fibers. And based on these results, which are assumed as good results because we keep in mind that microplastics are very persistent molecules, and we had quite a lot of fibers in the water here to oxidize. We optimized this process and we investigated, we explored the changes on the surface of these fibers that took place during treatment. And we can see that when we had no treatment here, and when we had only hydrogen peroxide, only an oxidant in the dark, the surface of the fibers was smooth and uniform. And the same can be seen here for UVC treatment, while when we have combined UVC with hydrogen peroxide, the surface of microplastics, of the microfibers, was pitted and rough here. These are images obtained from a scanning electron microscope. And also, we can also see some debris on the surface of this fiber here, which we assumed that these debris comes from the fragments, smaller fragments of plastic in the water. And this was also observed by optical microscopy, where you can see the initial fibers in water here before treatment, and after treatment you can see increased fragments of plastic into the water. So we were able to observe changes on the physical changes on the surface of the fibers. And then we started studying the different factors of the different factors that could influence the operation of this process. And one important factor on this was the effect of UV dose, that the effect of UV dose on the removal rate, the removal percentage of microplastics. And we can see in this graph that when we increase the UV dose from 100 joules per square centimeter to 700 joules per square centimeter for the coupled, for the combined UVC hydrogen peroxide process, then we can see that we are able to achieve about 55% removal of microfibers from the water, which is a very good, which is a huge increase in the removal. So this means that the coupled UVC hydrogen peroxide process can be a promising technology, can be a promising technology for the treatment, for the removal of microplastics from water. Of course, this happened after 48 hours of treatment in the lab in order to achieve the UV dose of 700 joules per square centimeter. But this is something that at large scale can be optimized and can be investigated in order to see how this UV dose can be achieved at larger scale systems. For example, we can use more intense UVC lamps with higher intensity, or increase the number of the lamps that we need, or increase the treatment time for the wastewater, the residence times of the wastewater into the reactor. All these are questions to be investigated, and also something that we need to check for the future and taking into account the energy consumption of the lamps. Also, some new technologies, for example, light emitting diodes is another possibility that can be used in wastewater treatment. And this is something that we have studied a lot. And as we said here, we achieved 55% removal of the microfiber, but then the question that follows is what happened to these microfibers, microplastics that were removed, and where did this end up? So in order to get more details about the mechanical properties of the actual microfiber that was treated, we got some atomic force microscopy images, and we can see the darker areas here on different sections of this fiber, that these darker areas stand for holes and cracks on the surface of the fiber. So we can see lateral cracks and holes across the surface of the material, and with AFM we were able to measure the depth of these holes, which is an important thing, and the depth range from 10 to 100 nanometers. And this means that fragments of this microplastic were released into the water. We still don't know if these fragments were actually mineralized into CO2 and water, or we just managed to split the microfiber into smaller fragments, which were actually released into the water, and then formation of nanoplastics or other soluble organic plastic materials that will need to be further investigated. Focusing now on the initial microfiber, we can assume that these cracks and holes, this physical change on the surface of the fiber, this means that the strength of the tensile strength of the initial material has now decreased. So we assume, or there is a probability, that this material now is not very strong and will be cracked or fragmented even more easily with more oxidants, with the attack of more hydroxyl radicals in the water. Another factor that we investigated, another operating parameter, was the effect of hydrogen peroxide, the effect of the oxidant on the efficiency of the process. And you can see in the first graph, the different concentrations of hydrogen peroxide that were added in the water. And the results showed that after 9 hours of treatment of combined UVC hydrogen peroxide treatment, we can see that as we increase the concentration of the additional oxidant, the hydrogen peroxide, into the water, the removal of fibers is increased up to 25%. But when the concentration of hydrogen peroxide goes up to 2000 milligrams per liter, then we can see a deep decrease in the removal efficiency. And this is something that we actually expect from the theory and the stoichiometry of the oxidation reactions, because there is a scavenging effect of hydroxyl radicals. With the excess of hydrogen peroxide, this scavenges the oxidants in the water, so there are no reactive oxygen species to degrade the pollutants, organic substances. So that's why we can see this deep decrease in the removal rate of microplastics. So that's another reason that we need to carefully monitor and optimize the addition of hydrogen peroxide during treatment, and, for example, be aware in which point the scavenging effect starts and what should be the maximum allowable concentration of hydrogen peroxide into the process. And after optimizing the process by studying the different operating factors that can significantly affect photocatalysis, we did experiments in real laundry wastewater. So we got wastewater samples from a hospital in Scotland, from their laundry machines. And this wastewater was pre-treated by coagulation and filtration processes. And we tested whether a UVC hydrogen peroxide process would be suitable in order to remove the remaining COD of this sample of about 500 milligrams per liter. I should say here that because this is a hospital, this wastewater comes from a hospital, we expected that more persistent organic substances, soluble substances, will be found in there. For example, pharmaceuticals, antibiotics, detergents, and other solvents. And we ran the UVC hydrogen peroxide treatment at the best conditions that we studied, and we could see that complete removal of COD was possible. Here, the black line. So COD is completely removed after about 3.5 hours of treatment. Of course, we assume sorry, just to finish this. So COD is removed, and at the same time, we can see that the microplastics that are found in this wastewater, there is no change in their mass for the first 3 hours here, but we can see that after 3 hours, the microplastics start, the removal of microplastics is starting. And if we compare these results with removal of microplastics in distilled, in deionized water, we can see that the removal started from the beginning of the treatment, but now we can see a delay for about 3 hours, and then the removal is starting. At the same time, all COD is removed during the first 3 hours of treatment. So this means that microplastics are more persistent substances, and the hydroxyl radicals, the oxidant species, prefer to firstly oxidize the COD, the other soluble organic pollutants that are found in this wastewater, and then start oxidizing the microplastics. So that's a very important finding, because our conclusion here would be that what would happen if we stop treatment at 3 hours? So at 3 hours, or at about 3 hours, we can see that we can achieve complete removal of COD, of other organic, soluble organic pollutants. And also, we can see that microplastics will not start be degrading, which means that microplastics will not be start degrading into smaller fragments of microplastics that cannot be really detected by mass loss methodology, or in nanoplastics, which are still pollutants, but it's a bit difficult to monitor them. So an optimization of the process here would require treatment for 3 hours, which can be feasible at large scale as well. And then we also studied the transformation of microfibers by sulfate-based oxidation processes. And we need a sulfate generator to add in the water, and this can be peroxymonosulfate, PMS, here, that can lead to the generation of hydroxyl radicals, or this can be peroxydil sulfate, PDS, that can also lead to sulfate generation and then to the generation of hydroxyl radicals and other oxidants into the water. And for these reactions to happen, we need to activate the sulfate generators, and activation can happen by different methods. We tried UV, UV radiation, ultrasounds, and heating in this work. And we monitor the changes, the physical and chemical changes on the surface of microfibers in order to see what happens to them, the cracks, the holes on the surface, and what happens in water quality after that. And here is a screening of activation processes. And we can see in the first graph the different irradiation techniques that were studied, results that can be very relevant to artificial weathering of microplastics as well, especially because we are using solar, simulated solar irradiation to see what changes on the surface on the fibers occur. And 24 hours, which can be regarded as a relatively short time, we can see that UVA and solar do not yield any significant changes on mass loss. But with UVC treatment, we can see changes on the mass of microfibers in water. And especially with high intensity UVC, because we have more energy coming into the water, that's why we have the generation of more hydroxyl radicals and other reactive oxygen species in the water. And these attack the surface of the microfibers. So we can achieve here about 30% removal, mass loss of the microfibers. With heat, we can see that at 60 degrees, the mass loss, the removal percentage is about 20% of microfibers from water, while 75% we can see that we barely have any removal from water. This was expected because thermolysis of the peroxide bond occurs at temperatures between 30 and 60 degrees. Of course, we also have some experiments which are not shown here. In degrees lower than 60, we didn't have any removal of microfibers from water. So we have a relatively good removal, 20%, but of course, we can't really use these degrees in wastewater treatment plants, in reality, in practice. We can't use it because these are really high degrees and will need lots of energy in order to maintain the system and large amounts of wastewater in such degrees. And then we used ultrasounds in order to activate the sulfate generation. And we can see that with high power ultrasounds of 500 watts, we can achieve about 50% removal of microfibers. which is a good, a very good removal percentage, but we decided to focus on UVC in this study because ultrasound generation required lots of energy to activate the sulfate system. And also, you can see here we observed by SEM images an increase in the fragmentation of fibers and also in the carbonyl index. The results are not shown here. So this means changes in the chemical composition of the surface of the fibers as well. So here are the fibers at the beginning of the treatment, and here are the fibers in about 60 minutes of treatment, and at the end, after 2 hours of treatment, that we can see clearly the breaking of the fibers from treatment when we went through this treatment. And then we did the experiments at the best conditions in real laundry wastewater from the hospital. It was the same wastewater that we used before. But here we can see, on contrary with the previous process, that the oxidation of fibers was delayed. Here we can see that the oxidation of fibers here started from the beginning of the process. So microfibers, the pitting and cracking on the surface, and the creation of smaller fragments and of nanoplastics. We are currently on the process of measuring nanoplastics in water and soluble plastics, intermediate products. Started from the beginning of the process, together, of course, with COD removal. But we can see that this process is more slow than the UVC hydrogen peroxide process that we studied before, more intense conditions and more oxidants generated in the water. And then a few slides on why the changes and monitoring and understanding of the changes, physical and chemical, on the surface of microfibers are important for wastewater treatment. So these are important because when there is cracking and holes and fragments on a microfiber, then this means that the surface, the actual surface of the microfiber is increased. So I have more available surface for other substances to be absorbed on this microfiber. And this is what happens in reality. And wastewater treatment plants have concentrated pollutants in there. So it's an ideal, it's a hot spot for absorption of pollutants on microplastics. And there are lots of works, and there is a recent review on absorption of organic pollutants on microplastics. And there are publications that have studied different compounds, and we can see that 27 of these compounds are benzene derivatives. Other are PAHs, PCBs, PFAS, the forever chemicals, very persistent, very recalcitrant organic pollutants that are absorbed onto microplastics. So we don't have only the microplastic material that is released into the environment, but also we have all these adsorbed pollutants and other biological pollutants, thus forming biofilms on them that are released into the environment and are becoming even more toxic to microorganisms and organisms that they will accumulate into. And we recently studied the adsorption of antibiotics on microplastics, and specifically the adsorption of ceftazidime. Ceftazidime is a third generation cephalosporin antibiotic. It's a potent antibiotic. It's used to fight superbugs. Superbugs that come from increased resilience to antibiotics. And I'm sure you have heard about the development of antibiotic-resistant bacteria in the environment. And for this, also wastewater treatment plants are a hot spot for the development of antibiotic-resistant bacteria, because lots of traces, small amounts of antibiotics are found in there. Many bacteria and other microorganisms are found in there, and antibiotic-resistant bacteria are developed in there. So these are some experiments, initial experiments, where we studied the microfibers, the pristine microfibers, again, that can be actually found in large quantities in wastewater treatment systems. And the adsorption of ceftazidime on them. So you can see that when you have a brand new microfiber with a smooth surface, then adsorption of antibiotic does not really happen, and after a while it remains smooth. But when we have a weathered, a treated microfiber, which is usually the case in wastewater treatment plants, because we have of the treated surface, we have even more surface for the antibiotic or any other pollutant to be adsorbed on, we can see that the amount of antibiotic that is adsorbed, the milligrams of antibiotic per grams of microplastic, are increased. And are increased a lot by the contact time, which is here measured in hours. So this study is currently under development, and we'll also study tire wire particles and foams, polystyrene, polyethylene, that is also found in wastewater treatment plants. So, as a conclusion of all of this, microplastics occur. There is a large amount of microplastics in wastewater treatment systems. And there is a big need to upgrade the existing systems in order to mitigate this problem and reduce pollution from microplastics from wastewater treatment plants. Existing treatments and weathering of microplastics leads to changes in their physical and chemical properties. As we saw, they don't remain intact. Their properties and their surface is altered. And this means that pollution from nanoplastics or soluble plastics in water is also increased. And It's very important to better understand how treatment systems and processes and the operating parameters of all these processes affect the degradation of microplastics, change their physical, their surface properties, because the surface of microplastics is a big contributor to adsorption of other pollutants, organic, chemical, and biological pollutants. So we create even more pollution than the initial microplastic. And of course, there's huge opportunities and research gaps on investigating further and optimizing the processes that we have for the removal and treatment of microplastics. And I would like to thank you here with a photo from Eddie Brainoto. Thank you
Okay,
so
thank you.
much.
So now it's question time. So have any questions?
Hello, Thalia. Thank you for that talk. Very interesting. I have a guess a question or given what you've said, I wonder if you do the initial COD removal and sort of changing the surface structure of the plastics with your UVC. Would it not make more sense then to switch to a filtration process at that point? Because you would have lost a lot of your organic material. But by then filtering, you would remove not only the plastics that were left there, but also any other organic contaminants that were adhering to the plastics.
That's an open, how can I say, an open topic in wastewater treatment. We can't really remove a pollutant or we can't tackle pollution with only one process. We need a treatment system. And it really depends on the type of the wastewater. You see, and the processes that goes into. We need to do the test in the lab scale, even if these are well-established processes, because wastewater has lots of peculiarities. It's never the same. One day from the other day, 1 hour from the other day, the characteristics, the quality of wastewater always changes. So, yeah, it would make sense to have a filtration process after the UVC in order to get all these pollutants out. But we also need to make sure we manage well the waste that will be produced from this filtration. So we filter something, we create clean water, but we still have the paste on the waste paste on the filter. We need to make sure we wash it back into the treatment system. Lots of things, I would say, lots of aspects to take into consideration. And all this depends on the context, in which industry or what type of wastewater we have to clean, and what is the pre-treatment, and taking into consideration all the life cycle of the plant. Yeah, oxidation and UVC will be just a tiny part on the whole train of systems. I don't know if this is clear.
Yes, that's very clear. So I guess my follow-up question then is, realistically, what do you think the time frame is to have somewhat effective removal of microplastics from waste systems?
That's a good question. I guess the time frame will depend on the regulations from government that will be set in place. I mean, we have the technology. We have the technologies because this will require a combination of technologies. For example, it might be a combined filtration with UVC in order to destruct, filter, but also clean, destruct the microplastics at the same time, or have many filters in series with UVC in the middle, or other technologies or biological techniques. We have technologies available, but I think we don't have, water industry don't have the initiative to apply, to deploy these technologies. And this will come when regulations, strict regulations from the government will be applied for wastewater treatment. And I think this will be done soon because there's a climate crisis we need to mitigate.
Okay, great, great presentation. So I may ask one question, because well, during the treatment with UVC or like the hydrogen dioxide, so the plastic will be broke, so it will be become the even smaller part, right?
Mm-hmm.
So generally, we think that the smaller when the particle size is becoming smaller. So it may be more toxic because they may be, you know, be able to enter, you know, the whole human bodies, even, you know, that cross the boundary for the like the cell, something like that. So do you think about that when you do the, you know, like the oxidation process? So how to evaluate the toxic effect?
Yeah. So toxicity studies is a big thing that need to complement all this removal, for example, COD removal or nanoplastics formation, analytical techniques of organic pollutants. We need toxicity studies, ecotoxicity, for example, on Vibrio fishery, Daphnia maga. There are lots of methods to measure ecotoxicity. But this is something that needs to be done and assessed in parallel with organic removal in order to find again the best process and the optimal treatment time and optimal other operating factors of the processes, of every process. But yeah, toxicity studies are very important in this case. And again, it's about balancing the toxic effects because microplastics absorb other pollutants, so they are toxic as well. And the huge research there about toxicity of biofilms on microplastics and also toxicity of the intermediate byproducts. And what's the, you know, balancing again the impact.
Okay. Yeah, thank you. Thank you. So
thank
any
you.
Other questions from all of you? Okay, so if no questions, so it's also a time to stop today's lecture. Thank you again, Sandhya. So
thank
for
you
the
so much.
Very excellent presentation and the lecture. So and you know, like next week at the same time. So actually, I will talk about something about the photo aging too, about this transformation of this microplastic. So see you next week.
Good. All right, I look
bye-bye.
forward for next week. Bye.
All right, bye.